Well, thanks for having me. This is a fantastic event, and I want to congratulate the mayor and also Penrith Council as a whole to really pull this very important day together. I hope by the end of the day, we can remember this in 10 years' time as this was the day when we started to actually change things. It would be great if we get to that. I'm working on urban heat. It's a lot of work, and it's very hot. And I'm even working with Penrith Council, and it's very hot, and I will show you some data from that research. So I titled this Living Urban Heat because we are living it. So we had IPCC telling us in 2013 that we can expect more extreme weather, more heat waves, more frequent heat waves, more intense heat waves. That was 2013, and they were predicting that for about 2025, 2030. Climate change was far away. It's actually now. Climate change is now. We are experiencing it, and it's actually very, very intense here in Penrith. So it's not that we're waiting for that any longer. It has arrived, and so we have to do something about it. A very nice view of Australia. Very, very crowded and extremely urbanized. We are adding at the moment, and I just checked before the talk, the number is still correct. We're adding one person to this country every 1 minute and 23 seconds. That's the growth rate that we actually have. It's enormous. Of course, all these people need to live somewhere, and Western Sydney is one of the places where they will live. Until 2036, we will have 1.6 to 1.8 more, million more people out here. They got to live somewhere. And we have heard already that urbanization itself already increases heat. And we're having climate change on top of that. So we're creating a very, very dire situation out here where we really need to rethink. And I can only repeat what Beck has said. We really need to do things now because these 1.8 million people, they are coming and we are building. I studied urban heat very intensively for three councils. Penrith is the fourth council. I today had made contact with a few more councils that are also interested in doing this type of work. One problem in urban heat is that some councils don't even have a bomb weather station, so they don't know what their temperature actually is. And then when they have one, maybe it's not where the people actually are. And also the regulations require that these bomb weather stations, so they become comparable across the globe, have certain conditions around them which do not actually reflect the built environment. So the temperatures that you get from your bomb station may not actually be the temperature that you're experiencing. And that's where I come in with this benchmarking research, really looking into whole council areas, distributing hundreds of sensors, measuring air temperature over summer, and then starting to produce products like these, where you have real data, hard evidence about where it's hot and where it's not so hot. So on your left, you see a map from Parramatta from a heat wave. There is a temperature difference of 13 degrees from Sydney Olympic Park over to Westmead. This is real data. This is real temperature at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. This is the difference that you have. And of course, you can use this now to make strategic decisions. There is another map that shows you the area around Campbelltown. That's the Campbelltown LGA, a little bit shortened to the east because we didn't go into Holsworthy much, but you can clearly see there's a heat island effect, and this is not modeled data again, it's the hard evidence that Campbelltown, Minto, Ingleburn, that area in the central part of the LGA is actually hotter. And this is mean nighttime temperature across February. So mean nighttime temperature is something like midnight to 5 o'clock in the morning. We average that for all those hundreds of points that you see, and these are the maps we're getting. So it's actually real. And we can use this now to make planning decisions. This is a video. I'm just going to start it. It's 3 days. We can now also use this data to actually start animating and visualizing heat so people really understand what happens in their LGA. So you can see a little clock at the top left. We're now into midday. Heat builds up. Interestingly, the western part of Parramatta LGA is always hotter. And when you look at the movement of cold and hot air, cold air always moves in from the northeast, which is where we earlier today saw maps where the canopy cover is greater. Also, we have an orographic lift, so you have elevation when you get into the hills to the north of Parramatta. So that's where cold air is pushing in the day, and then is also retracting, is retracting towards the day and then going back into Parameter during the night. So that's your usual flow. What is also interesting to look at is how, in the end, heat enters from the west and retreats also towards the west. And this is, again, data. It's not modeled. We're using hundreds and hundreds, for this animation, probably hundreds of thousands of data points to actually then come up with these products to communicate heat in a different way. So I just let that finish. That was the 44 degree day. You can also see across the LGA that it's quite variable. It's not the same temperature everywhere. And this is, again, something that's very important to look at, because you find areas that are cool. You don't need to do an intervention there. You find areas that are really hot. That's where you concentrate your limited resources. So for Penrith, we have this grid that we use to roll out our logger network for air temperature. And for this event today, we had 10 extra sensors that we put out, and I got the data back and analyzed it and have a few results that I can show. I did measure 51.5 degrees air temperature. On the 4th of January, everyone is talking about the 49 or 48.9. It was actually 51.5 for some people up at Agnes Banks. Extremely hot. Last year, I was saying we get to 50 degrees temperature. I didn't expect that it would be 1 year later that I actually already measure that. I also measured, just to let you know, in Parramatta North, 50.5. So it's not just out here where it's extreme hot. And this is when you get into built environment. So we are getting extreme temperatures that are, of course, extremely hazardous for young people and for old people, for the sick. It's something that we do need to address because it becomes a hazard. Just for Penrith, it was very interesting to see there's a very large temperature gradient towards the river. The Tench Reserve only had 2 days above 40 degrees, whereas in St. Mary's, we already had 7 days. And these are just the first results. So I'd be, of course, interested when I got my hundreds of sensors back of where else we find hot spots and cool spots. Generally, the areas to the south, interestingly, of course, that is where we see a lot of development. That's the Aerotropolis. There's Badgerys Creek, and there will be the airport. That's actually a cool zone for a council where hot air could cool off. Where also wind streams for your southerly busters would pick up some cooler air and push that through the LGA. So once you start building in this region, of course, that will change. This is on 10th of January, just to explain a tiny little bit about what we're experiencing and why. So this is actually at the river, and then this is the Panthers car park. So it's very local, very Penrith. 29 degrees on the river at about midday, 34 degrees. And that's just 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers. That's the distance. You already get 5 degrees in air temperature that are different. But of course, because we are now moving from the Tench Reserve with its natural surfaces, grass mostly, into hard surfaces, build-up space, we get very different surface temperatures. And that is then radiated. And when you look at the fields-like temperature, we get about 20 degrees different. If you would be at the same time in two different areas, if you could do that, if you can, I don't know, time traveled and you can do that. So if you would be in both places, you experience a difference of 20 degrees. That is enormous. But it also gives us an opportunity now to address, for example, how we cool down car parks. We also look into the different influences of urban and natural environments on temperature. And for doing that, we teamed up with Campbelltown and start to analyze urban space in a very detailed way. We have these air temperature measurements from our logger networks. We know exactly where we are. In this instant, we would be, let's see if this laser works. Yeah, we would be here in the center of a circle that's about 50 meters in radius. That would be a tree where we hung our little air temperature sensor. And now we analyze the area around it. What is it composed of? How does it look like? So we start to understand how is air temperature at a very micro scale actually influenced by the different building materials, how much open space we have, how much blue space we have, and so on. And the first analysis that I pulled off this data are very, very telling. Think of these like sliding scales. When you increase the area of hard surfaces, you actually increase temperature. So I take in this area of hard surfaces, I take buildings and roads and car parks. When you have the area of open and green space together and increase that, you cool. So now you can start to develop your plans according to how much of which space will I actually put into my development and start to see an effect on air temperature. Knowing that, for example, if you increase open space, you cool, and if you reduce hard surfaces and built environment, you also reduce temperature because you're sliding backwards on that red line. So therefore, you make an impact on temperature. This is a tool how we could actually use our data to influence how your development will turn out in terms of the microclimate. Like Beck said, it's time to rethink. So I'm really thinking this is not the Australian dream that we always hear about. People want their single standing or single dwelling, single standing homes. This is the Australian nightmare when it comes to heat. It probably also is the nightmare when it comes to public health or even the social interaction between the people, because they're just inside. It's too hot outside. You can't actually plant a tree in this environment anymore. So nobody's moving outside, nobody's living outside, because there's just no shade and really no reason to be outside anyway. So I do challenge this, and I want to show you this because this is possible. This is what people actually build. Look, when this was done in the US, 2009, that's 11 years ago. And we are still building what I just showed before. So these developments are fantastic. They're relatively high density, but they leave open space. They incorporate blue space. They have amenity and retail space. They have a cinema in this complex, and they also have walking distance to public transport, trams, light rail. They have no cars. So all of this is possible. It's built 11 years ago. I think we can actually start doing something different. And once we address whole precincts, then of course we need to look at part of my research at schools, how we can cool schools down, because kids are very vulnerable to heat. And heat impacts learning outcomes. If we have increasing heat through increasing climate change and therefore more extreme temperatures in summer, we will also see an effect on learning outcomes in schools. We use these maps now. This is a real map that we developed for a school in Parramatta. This is a project with DPIE and the Department of Ed, where we can now pull out time for recess and playtime in the afternoon when they have their lunch breaks. And we can actually look at where is it hot in the schoolyard and where is it cool, and therefore help the educators and the teachers and so on to inform where the kids should play or should not play when it's very warm outside. So we do that, and we also look at playgrounds, which is a real passion of mine, because we are building them in a way that is not helping them to use these playgrounds for kids. This was on the 4th. I was actually out there. It was brutal. 63 degrees feels like temperature. And that is because we are putting in this AstroTurf that you can see in the background of the image that is actually having a surface temperature of 90 degrees. And we're not shading it. If we shade it, that's all right. We can still use it, but we're not. These are the neighborhood playgrounds. Cumberland Council has 200, more than 200 of them. These are the playgrounds where the grandpas go with the grandkids because the parents are at work. They cannot use them during the summer. It's impossible, and it becomes actually a hazard. And again, this is something we can change. And with that, I leave you by acknowledging the partners of this research and take any questions later. Thank you. Thank you.